Dick Slater, like him or not, he is the new United States heavyweight champion.
That he is.
You say what you want about him, David. Dirty Dick Slater, the unpredictable one. No one likes his actions in the ring. But the man he defeated for that belt
is definitely a man, John. You have to say
Greg
that.
Greg Valentine, but David, he's also a mean, nasty individual, not very well liked in the area. And these two guys, if and when they do meet, maybe they'll do us all a favor and destroy each other. Neither one very well liked, David, and now they don't like each other.
All right, you have to respect both Dick Slater and Greg Valentine because these men are tough.
Mean, nasty.
When they walk in that ring, they walk in to wrestle. They walk in to punish their opponent and to win any way they can.
At any cost.
Yes.
Both of them. Long time Valentine's had that reputation.
Especially Dick Slater right now. You know, Dick Slater, he's a man with no conscience. He doesn't care what he does. But if it took beating his mother, I think he'd do that.
Well, we haven't had the United States, former United States heavyweight champion Greg Valentine has no bed of roses, or he didn't go around kissing no babies.
No, he didn't.
All the time that Greg Valentine had it.
But John, there's one thing about Valentine, is that it never took two people. Valentine always did it by himself.
Face to face.
That's right.
He always started out one on one and never come from behind to get it to club anybody with that hammer, and boy can he club you with that hammer.
He definitely can.
Of course, I know also that we watched Dick Slater in action, his close cohort Bob Orton. We cannot forget, because they have been partners in crime. They put Ric Flair out for 5 weeks.
That they did.
They hurt Wahoo McDaniel's arm. Wahoo had to have surgery, and they both doubled up on Greg. And I'm sure Greg, even though he wants that belt back, he wants Slater back. I'm sure he is not going to forget about Orton for a long time.
That's right.
Either.
Nobody's going to forget about Orton, and nobody's going to forget about Dick Slater. Wahoo McDaniel's, he hadn't forgotten about him. He wants to sign any match, any way he can, any way, to get hold of Dick Slater and Bob Orton Jr. He doesn't care. He doesn't care what he has to do. Matter of fact, he's already said that he has to pull his arm off, and beat him with
it. And he wouldn't give up either.
No, he won't.
He wouldn't give up either if he had to do that, because he's never given up in a match. He had his leg broken. He had his arm injured enough, but he had to have surgery on the elbow from Slater and Orton. And he still hasn't given up. He's back to wrestling again. Maybe too soon, maybe not. We'll see.
We'll find out. That's right, because that's what they're going to go after. All right, Dick Slater now. Thanks. Slammed down on that mat. Look at him. Takes his time. Goes for the pin. Count of two.
Side suplex executed by the champion. And we have to call him champion now,
yes,
because he is United States heavyweight champion.
And ladies and gentlemen, the United States heavyweight champion, when you talk about champions, that is a tough one to hold on to. Besides the United States heavyweight champion, you have the world heavyweight champion, Ric Flair. And then you talk about Dick Slater and Bob Orton Jr. They injured him, tried to keep him from going after Harley Race.
The United States heavyweight champion there, Dick Slater, and the NWA heavyweight champion, World Flair, Ric Flair. The NWA champion, the world major leagues of professional wrestling. You see the best right there.
The very best.
And now the action continues. Slater has him in the rope. Down to the mat goes Keith Larson, driver pinned by the United States champion. Great move by Keith Larson. He fires away.
Listen, Larson now takes him, whips him into the ropes, comes up.
Oh,
trying to catch him with a back drop. The champion that he is, Dick Slater, caught it with an elbow in the back of the neck. Now watch him now. Watch him go to work on this young man. Picks him up.
Double arm suplex, David.
Yes,
he's got set.
Takes his time now.
Control.
That's what he has. That's what makes him the champion that he is.
Just one step ahead. Beat him running that back drop. It could have changed the
fight, John. Now watch this. Watch what he does. Drops it back. Again, right back on the back. Knocks the wind out. Goes for the pin.
We've got a winner. The United States
see how Dick Slater won the United States Heavyweight Championship against the Hammer Greg Valentine. And this has been a hard-fought match. There you see. Slater's basically knocked out on the road.
Hey, Robert!
Heavyweight Championship, it's Dick Slater.
It's no surprise to me, because I set out a goal, and that was to take every major title I could get my hands on. Now, I got something to say a little while from now, but I got something to say right now. It's very important to me and very important to the organization which we have formed. Like I said before, we're going to take every kind of major title there was. And Bob Orton Jr. and Don Carnoodle have done that. They are now the new World's Tag Team Champions. And I'd like to congratulate both of them on a fine job done.
Fine United States champion, Dickie, thank you very much for the congratulations. It was a long, hard-fought tournament. The Road Warriors, the Von Erichs, there were people in that tournament that positively nobody thought could be beat. But Don Carnoodle and I stepped out of the tournament number one, Daddy, the new World Tag Team Champions. Donald, go ahead and translate
exactly
to your
head. Right. Mayors rule cities. Governors rule states. President rules countries. But Orton and Carnoodle, we rule the whole entire tag team wrestling world. And if these belts could talk, they'd say, Orton and Carnoodle, you're the greatest tag team in the world today, and you're the only ones worthy enough to wear me around your waist. Right, Orton?
That's right, Daddy. And believe it or not, we've got something that's going to be even greater news for all you people out there. We are making communications with the Russians. Oh, yes, we're getting along just fine. We found out how to break the ice. Come on, Daddy. Come on over here. Yes, yes, yes. Thank you.
Basically, when I first started out, I said I was a greedy individual, and that I am. But I'd like to do something right now in my good faith, in my good honor. And I'd like to present the Mid-Atlantic Heavyweight Championship to Ivan Koloff.
Wait a minute, Dick, you just
don't
can't give
me,
him the
wait
belt.
A minute. The man respectably owns this belt. He owns the championship. He is a new Mid-Atlantic Heavyweight Champion. And if these people out here don't like it, well, they can send their letters in to Crockett Promotions. And I'm sure that I'm not going to care whether they send one or not. But this man right here, this man right here, as a new Mid-Atlantic Heavyweight Champion, I am taking myself right to you, Flair, for the gold. You're next. You're next in line.
All right, there you
go. Now you see it. The Mid-Atlantic John Heavyweight Champion, Ivan Koloff. What happened?
Evidently, Koloff has got that belt, David. There has to be a story behind this belt. Is Koloff in the ring? He's got a new opponent. And he got the belt.
I still can't believe that Dick Slater, as you saw, Dick Slater gave that championship, Mid-Atlantic Heavyweight Championship, to Ivan Koloff. And with me, I have the World Heavyweight Champion, Ric Flair. Rick?
Well, David, it's always a pleasure to be here. You know, the National Wrestling Alliance, as you know and I know so well, is the greatest wrestling body in the world today. And it's always a pleasure. It's more than a pleasure. It's the most fantastic feeling in the world to be able to walk out here and know that I represent the best. I'm the World Heavyweight Champion. When you talk about the men that have held it before, the Jack Briscoes, the Dory Funk Juniors, the Harley Races, the list is endless of great champions. I like to think of myself as a great champion, and that means that I've got to wrestle and defeat the best the wrestling has to offer. And I'm talking about the Bob Ortons, the Dick Slaters, the Valentines, the Wahoo McDaniels, the Ricky Steamboats, the Youngbloods, the Roddy Pipers. The list is endless. The finest competition that I have to offer is right here in this area. And I'm the World Heavyweight Champion, and I intend to stay the World Heavyweight Champion, and that means I'll wrestle anybody on any occasion. And that includes Ivan Koloff. Now, this is the first time I've had an opportunity to see Koloff in a long time. He's come in here under the tutelage of Gary Hart. We all know what kind of man Gary Hart is. Now, Koloff, a former world champion himself, a tremendous athlete, probably one of the finest conditioned athletes to ever participate in our sport. And then Bubba Douglas here, or Bubba Smith rather, he's going to have to show everybody tonight just what kind of man he is, because this fellow that Koloff is wrestling will give him a tremendous match. Just like It sends Koloff reeling out to the floor, but Koloff, never slackening the department, is getting right back in the ring, and he's ready for anything that Bubba Douglas has.
All right, Bubba Douglas tried it. Koloff went right back on him, pounding away at that midsection. He's a powerful individual.
Well, he's a tremendous, tremendous athlete. As I said before, his conditioning is second to none. It's a tremendous honor to be here and see the caliber of wrestlers now participating in the sport here in this area. And as much as I don't like him, I can't say enough about a guy like Orton. And there you go. Excuse me. Didn't mean to interrupt your train of thought, but Koloff just got his hand raised, and he beat this man in a very short period of time. That shows you what kind of athlete he is.
For these commercial messages about the worldwide wrestling events coming up in your area.
It's a great card of wrestling at the Roanoke Civic Center Sunday, January 22nd at 3 p.m. You'll see such stars as Ernie Ladd, The Assassins 1 and 2, Gary Hart will be there, Paul Jones, Ivan Koloff, Dick Slater, Greg Valentine, Rufus R. Freight Train Jones, Mark Youngblood, Wahoo McDaniel, Jimmy the Boogie Woogie Man Valiant, and Ricky Steamboat. A big card is coming to Harrisonburg at the Harrisonburg High School Gym in Harrisonburg, Virginia, Thursday, January the 19th at 8:15. Ivan Koloff, Bob and Barry Orton, Dick Slater, Mark Youngblood, Greg Valentine, and Chief Wahoo McDaniel all will be there. And fans, a super card comes to the Lynchburg Armory Saturday, January the 21st at 8:15. Hans Schroeder takes on Mark Youngblood. For the Mid-Atlantic title, Ivan Koloff defends against Angelo Mosca Jr., then to cap it off, the World's Tag Team Champions. Bob Orton Jr. and Don Cornette up against Chief Wahoo McDaniel and Angelo King Kong Mosca. Let's bring in the Mid-Atlantic champion, Ivan Koloff, defending against Angelo Mosca Jr.
You know, I'm very proud of this belt, Mid-Atlantic Championship. Not that it's worth a lot of money. It's just metal and leather. But it's what it represents, you know, in this country. The area that it covers. Any place a television shows, Ivan Koloff is Mid-Atlantic champion. That means that I am the best. And I don't care, Mosca Jr., you know, your big man goes around, your old man goes around saying, Hoppa, Koloff is scared of him after wrestling on television, how he beat me up. He never had me beaten at any time. I know he's a tough man, and I know his son has been trained very well. But when I come into Lynchburg Armory, I'm going to be ready for this junior. And he better be good, because I hate slapping young punks around. You know, all the girls are going to be screaming for him. But he's not going to look so good after I yank his hair out of his head and leave scars all over his body. I'm going to shoot you down, Junior, just like as if you were a plane and I was the Russian missile.
And fans, then it's the World's Tag Team Champions, Don Cornette, Bob Orton Jr. against Angelo Mosca and Wahoo McDaniel.
Exactly right. Surprise, surprise, surprise. I know you're glad that the World Tag Team belts are in the right hands again.
Yeah, and he is definitely a man. You might not like him, you might not care for him, but you have to respect the hammer Greg Valentine, because he can hammer away at you. John, as you well know, because you felt it before, when Valentine puts you over that rope, bends you back, and he drops that arm across you, it'll just cave your chest in.
It certainly will. He hits harder as anybody in professional wrestling. That's how he got the name of that hammer. You see him right there. The belt may be gone, but the hammer ain't gone.
That's
the nastiness is not gone. The vile temper and all the things and the shortcuts he takes in the ring, he's still going to be the same.
Oh, yes, he is.
The only thing, he may have a little desire in his heart right now to get one of his own kind.
I think it
breaks rule just like he does.
All right, now watch Valentine. He'll use that right. He'll lay you out. He's wrestling with a vengeance. All right, now. There you see him, pound away at the back. Now watch him. He picks John Vanilla up. Just takes his shot, drops him.
Reverse suplex. Dropped Vanilla right on the back of his head. And this man, John Vanilla, he may be taking a little of the wrath that is in Valentine's heart right now for Bob Orton and Dick Slater.
I got news for you. He doesn't have a fraction of what Valentine is going to give to Dick Slater and Bob Orton Jr. Valentine takes his time. He's a wrestler, John, that takes his time, punishes his opponent.
Always has methodical style, and if he doesn't out-wrestle him, he beats him half to death.
Yes, he does.
Submission anyway.
Greg Valentine, as I said, he was the greatest United States heavyweight champion ever. Dick Slater now is claiming that title. But I really think, John, that you have to say both Dick Slater and Bob Orton Jr. should be qualified as the United States Heavyweight Champion, since it took both of them to win it.
Certainly did, David. There's Valentine. Nobody has liked him ever in professional wrestling.
But you have right to respect
now,
him.
Oh, they've always respected him. But right now, he had a little dirty deal happen to him by one of his own kind.
That's right.
And now we'll see how two of their own kind fight each other. And they'll probably fight each other tooth and nail, just like they fight.
All right, look at Valentine. Lay that forearm. Now, that's a legal blow. That forearm is a legal blow. All right, now Valentine. Okay, here it comes. He is going to punish Bonello. Slams him right on that arm.
Full body slam with that arm in the hammerlock position.
Now watch this.
And he stays right on that same arm. Right on that arm. Methodically working on the arm, beating the man in submission, and he stays right on it. He knows he's wearing him down, David.
Yes, he is.
What's on Valentine's mind when the bell rings?
You notice he's not even trying to pin him. He's not going for the pin. He's wearing him down. Takes him down. Vanilla throws him out of that ring. Watch out, John.
That's the way he's always been. He's not going to change anything just because he got a dirty deal from Slater and Orton. He's the same man.
He is Greg Valentine, the Hammer. All right, watch this. You know, all right, cameraman, you bend him back. Here he goes. Watch it.
Oh!
He takes that chest in.
And that shot you bring out clear
Greg
over.
Vanilla knocks the wind out of him, John.
That shot rang out clear through our auditorium here.
Look at it, John. He bends him back again. He's going to cave it in. Listen to the fans. They want him to do it again.
Some of our fans are actually cheering for Valentine.
Yes, they are.
I can't believe it.
They want Valentine to cave his chest in with that arm, and he can do it. All right, now he picks Bonello up. Picks him up high. Drops him.
Backbreaker right across his knee.
Bonello's out. John, he's out.
Is he going to deliver the elbow? The elbow, the bionic elbow. Valentine on that second turnbuckle. And all that weight down on John Bonello.
Some of these fans are cheering Greg Valentine. Valentine, he's winning by sheer
reverse
punishment.
Headlock. He's got that arm hooked back. This could be.
I have to say that when he bends his opponent across that rope and lays that right hand on their chest, he hits the hardest of any wrestler in the world today, Greg Valentine.
Well, David, thank you. I just wish it was Dick Slater I was draping across that top rope, or Bob Orton Jr. The people saw. The film speaks for itself. They saw at the top of the show, they saw exactly what happened. They saw I had Dick Slater in a bad way. They saw how Bob Orton Jr. came in and distracted me. They both ought to be wearing my title, not just Dick Slater. They ought to cut it in half, and they both be United States champion. Slater, you didn't win the belt by yourself, that's obvious. And Orton, you're Dick Slater's stooge. That's obvious too. Unpredictable Dick Slater. You know, I've known the guy for a long time, 10 years or better. And now I know exactly why they call him Unpredictable. Another name he doesn't like too well, but it fits the picture perfectly, is Dirty Dick Slater. That's how I want everybody to call him, address him as Dirty Dick Slater. And Cowboy Bob Orton, Slater's stooge. But he's a rich stooge. He's not doing it for nothing. He's making a lot of money, same way he did when they both jumped Flair. But all I want is a chance, you understand me? All I want is a chance to have either one of them in that squared circle.
There you see him, Paul Jones and the Assassins. Paul Jones has Jimmy Vance's beard in that bag. Well, now, the Assassin, the stouter one, is in that ring. And he is a stout one, too. He's against Michael Samuel Houston. Houston now makes that tag.
And Bubba Smith now enters the ring on the Assassin. Paul Jones outside the ring. You saw Jimmy Valiant's spirit in his hand. And we know that the Boogie Woogie Man from New York City is really upset about that, because it took him about 5 years to grow that beard. And that was a prized possession.
That's right. And you know, a man that helped Jimmy Valiant, I'm talking about the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes. Well, Dusty, we have an interview, and he is coming. He is coming to help Jimmy Vane. Let's hear from Dusty right now.
Just a message. You, Paul Joseph, says I want you to hear good. Boy Funk Jr., whoever at my point, I don't care who they are. Brothers of the road, I'm gonna make you wish that you just scared to death of me. I know when you get up in the morning, you're gonna be scared to death of Mac Dream. I'm gonna make sure that to the day you live long as you want to, you're gonna feel some aching in your heart, some bad vibes in your heart, because the Mac Dream coming for you, Jones the Assassin, and my man, the Boogeyman. Brother of the road. Then now we gonna see the final chapter take hold. Cause whoever wanna be my partner, I'm gonna get deep down in your soul, Assassin and Paul Jones.
All right, there you had it, David. And you know there's another man that Jimmy Valiant said was one of the toughest men he ever fought. He tried to get him with a lot of money, offered him a lot of money to come and help him. The man agreed to help him when he heard Paul Jones' name, but he agreed to do it not for $10,000, not for $20,000, but for $1. $1.
$1, John.
Because Paul Jones is on the other team, this man, the Baron Von Raskin.
Oh, boy.
Has agreed to help Jimmy Valiant, and he will do it for $1.
That is something, because like you said,
Jimmy offered him a lot of money. I talked with a Boogie Woogie man about that, and he said, can you imagine of all the tough matches I've had to fight against Rusty, who was one of the toughest men that I've ever wrestled? I offered him all kind of money, and he said, when I mentioned Paul Jones, he said, I would do it for $1.
Well, Jimmy Vance, I know he's mad, but he's got to control himself because, John,
he's going to get at Paul Jones.
I know, but he's got to go through those two men right there, the Assassins. And I'm sure that Jimmy Vance will do anything and everything to get through the Assassins to Paul
Jones. Oh, nice move here by Sam Houston. And the Assassin saves himself. Here is Bubba Smith in.
He pounds away at him, takes him, whips him across into the ropes. Backdrop. High into the air. But quickly, the Assassin turns over, gets up.
He pointed that pin situation and catches Bubba Smith in a backdrop position. Now, he misses an elbow. Sam Houston quickly in the ring, gets caught with a tackle.
Yes, he did. Put that head right in the midsection. Makes the tag to the other Assassin. Keeps him close to that corner. Though you see that right hand right to the jaw. Makes the tag now. Whips him into the ropes. Comes off.
Oh!
Scoop slam. Hard down on that mat.
Power slam. Sets up Sam Houston. This man is a tower of strength, David. He's got arms like oak trees out there. Fire! Power slam again.
All right. Ladies and gentlemen, after this match, ladies and gentlemen, you're going to see something. And it is going to be something.
Assassins.
A friend of ours, Bob Caudle, is going to interview Paul Jones. Let's hear from them right now.
See what happens.
They see that scoop slam again. Hard down on that mat. And the Assassins are your winners.
Talking about the Assassins, and I mentioned earlier, here is Paul Jones. And Paul, I must have been right about what you had in that bag.
That's right. Let me tell you something. I can't say enough about the Assassins. But for the benefit of you people, this is Jimmy Valiant's beard, the one he said he lost. Well, he didn't lose it. Here it is.
All right, now, I want to show the fans just where that came from and how they got it. I've got a tape of this, Paul. Now, we're going to talk to you about it, but let the fans see this and see exactly what happened. And fans, here it is. Jimmy Valiant in the ring, and here are the Assassins now grabbing Valiant, slamming him back to the ropes and holding him. And look who's got the scissors. Look who's in the ring with the scissors. Grabs that beard. Snip, snip, snip. There you go, Paul.
Three of you right there on
Jimmy Valiant, cutting the beard as Valiant's in the ropes. And fans, here you get a good look at it as they're just shearing him with those scissors. It took two to hold him. The Assassin's holding him in the ropes. You cut him.
Let me tell you something. That goes to show that Jimmy Valiant is nothing but a coward. He can't even keep his own beard. Let me tell you something. You're not going to see Jimmy Valiant around here very long. He's so embarrassed. We proved, and what a coward he is. And there's no way that you see that Jimmy Valiant.
Angelo Mosca Jr.
Certainly is, David, a well-conditioned athlete, going to be a real star, superstar in the future, and we're very happy that the injury he received from the hands of Gary Hart and his two, what do you want to call it?
Henchmen.
He's completely well now. I know that's really good news for Angelo Mosca Sr. However, the attack still's got a stick in inside Senior and also inside of Junior.
Yes, I was just watching him. Young man, it's what I like. He's cautious enough. He's aggressive enough. He has that nice in-between quality.
Well, he has a lot of maturity already.
Yes, his father has taught him very well.
Doesn't run into make a foolish mistake. He's very disciplined already. Fine escape. Comes off the ropes. Handspring over. Headlock and very fine by Angelo Mosca Jr. And I wonder if Gary Hart might be somewhere on a monitor trying to get an eyeful
of
the man who's well, because he's going to have to face both Moscas. And as Angelo Sr. has said, it's vengeance is mine.
Yes.
And Italian vengeance can be rough.
It really can.
He's already running Kevin Sullivan out of the area. He sent Maniac Mark Lewin packing with his bag. We don't see them anymore. Gary Hart went to a lot of expense to surround himself with Don Carnoodle, Ernie Ladd, we understand.
Yes, he's.
Ivan Koloff would surround himself with some more protection. But the Mouses went through Sullivan and Lewin already, and I'm sure they will not be denied.
John, you have to say, Gary Hart being the world-class manager that he is getting the talent, a lot of talent, big wrestlers. He has put out money. He's even put out a reward or a bounty, if you want to call it that, on Angelo Mosca Sr. And I know he's probably got one now on Junior right now, too.
Well, what I think is he's paid.
Chief
is back, and he's ready. You see the bandage on that elbow, David, that was laid open. Had a 12-stitch cut that they cleaned out, the bone chips that was perpetrated by Bob Orton and Dick Slater. The chief is back, and he's ready, and, you know, he still hasn't given up.
That's right. They had to sand, I understand, one of the bones down. Had to sand and chip it down because it was in such bad shape. But look at it. He comes right back. You can still see it swollen.
And we talk about,
he doesn't give up.
We talk about Greg Valentine hitting harder than anyone. No one chops as hard as Wahoo McGann.
That is right.
You know, and there's one right across the nose of Ben Alexander's, and that'll bring tears to the eyes.
You know, John, it's a shame that the two men, Greg Valentine and Wahoo McDaniels, have such a different point of view on everything. But can you imagine seeing those two guys teamed up? That chop and that hammer.
And the temper of those two guys. half an inch long.
That's right. It would be like an atomic bomb going off in that
ring. We have seen them in some brutal matches against each other. Right, now, here's Wahoo.
Bends him back. He's trying to get, I almost, if he can get that arm out, he can try to get a sugar on him.
He's got a half Nelson, and he's got the other arm hooked, and Ben Alexander's going to have to use up a lot of energy to keep their shoulders off the mat.
Oh, here come those chops. When you talk about a man that can chop.
Oh! That one almost cut his head off. This one he's going to try. Let's see, one off the rope.
Yes,
sir! And Ben Alexander doesn't know what hit him. Went across the head, lateral press, and we got a winner. One of his famous chops, and watch this follow through. He really takes Ben Alexander off his feet. The winner, Wahoo McDaniels.
Let's take time out for these commercial messages about the worldwide wrestling events coming up in your area.
Sunday, January 22nd, 3 o'clock in the afternoon, wrestling returns to the Roanoke Civic Center with such stars as Ernie Ladd, the Assassins 1 and 2, Paul Jones, Gary Hart, Ivan Koloff, Dick Slater, Greg Valentine, Rufus R. Freight Train Jones, Mark Youngblood, Wahoo McDaniel, Jimmy the Boogie Woogie Man Valiant, Ricky Steamboat, many others will be there, you'll be there too. A big card comes to Harrisonburg, Virginia at the high school gym, Thursday, January the 19th at 8:15. Such stars as Ivan Koloff, Bob and Barry Orton, Greg Valentine, Dick Slater, Mark Youngblood, and Chief Wahoo McDaniel. And then there's a super card coming to the Lynchburg Army Saturday, January the 21st, starting at 8:15. You'll see Hein Schroeder take on Mark Youngblood. For the Mid-Atlantic title, Ivan Koloff defends against Angelo Muska Jr. And then the World's Tag Team Champions will be there. Bob Orton Jr. and Don Cornette teaming up against Wahoo McDaniel and Angelo Muska Sr. Let's bring in Angelo Muska Jr. You get your title shot against Ivan Koloff for the Mid-Atlantic title.
Tony, this is the biggest thing that's happened to me in my career. My opportunity to take on Ivan Koloff in the title match. You know, they call the man the Russian bear. They must call him that for a reason. He's a big, strong man. You know, just picture a bear running through the woods. That's probably the type of man he is in the ring. Well, Ivan Koloff, I'm going to come ready, too. Just be ready, Ivan.
Fans, you'll see the World's Tag Team Champions, Bob Orton Jr. and Don Cornette. And they will be wrestling Chief Wahoo McDaniel and Angelo Muska Sr.
Well, you know, Angelo, they come a long ways. You know, Orton and Cornette are now the World's Champions. And they're going to come and they're going to defend their title all over. Well, let me tell you something, Cornette, Orton, you bit off a little more than you may be able to chew up and spit out. You know, you got Muska here, 300 pounds, me around 260. We've been together before, we played football together and against each other, and we know quite a bit about each other. Now, we're going to step into the ring, we're not total strangers. And we know you are the world's champions, and Cornette was one half the world's tag team champions last year, so it's no strange position for him, Angelo. So I'm going to tell you one thing. Just get your...
Young man.
That you do.
Received a broken foot recently in a match with the Briscoe brothers. Jay is now, as you see, on crutches and in a cast. He's been in about 2 weeks. He has four or six to go. We'll be glad to see him back in action because he really takes a seat.
That's right. That match took its toll on him. But in there right now, his brother, Mark Youngblood. And he carries on that tradition. He's a ball of fire.
Talk about here. The Muskas with the Italians, well, these Indians got it too. Jay and Mark, Jake, a little older, Mark coming right along with the footsteps, a little bigger maybe, a little stronger, chops a little harder, not quite as fast, but together like bread and butter.
That's right. Right now he's got a good partner in there. He's got Rufus R. Freight Train Jones. But Mark right now, he's... Hans Schroeder now takes him. Takes him over.
Is able to escape on the outside. Let's not forget there's Rufus R. Jones out there, who is Mark Youngblood's partner. And Marcus, the last 3 or 4 weeks, teamed with Rufus.
God, did you see that? Boy, he cut him. He cut him down.
Gary Royal in there scored with a good elbow. Marcus got a lot of experience from Rufus R. Jones in the past several weeks. And he's really maturing as another one of the young lions like Muska Jr. And David, we got to say, what an incident that was with the Boogie Woogie.
Oh, yes.
Is that a man after somebody?
Like we were saying, John, he's going to do anything and everything. He said, doesn't matter where he sees Paul Jones, he's going to get it.
He had him on the floor, the hair of the head, and he had a pair of scissors in his hand.
That's right.
You know what his intentions was.
He's going to take his head off. But, you know, he went right through the assassins, and that's what he's going to try to do in the ring, out of the ring. He's going to go through the assassins.
The thing about the Boogie Woogie Man, we've seen him have trouble with a lot of different guys. Way back, it was Humperdinck and his bunch.
Yes.
He always got done what he said he's going to do.
That's
and
right.
Now, how would you like to see a Paul Eddie Jones? He wouldn't be so pretty anymore, would he?
They'd call him Mr. Queen.
Hey, we got to remember that the Boogie Woogie Man has always got done what he said that he is going to do.
Yes, that is true. Right now, Rufus R. Freight Train Jones is in there. Hans Schroeder goes after him, rakes the eyes, scratches the eyes. Snap Mare takes him over. This is really trying to slow Rufus down, and you have to keep Rufus down.
An interesting development with Rufus that you mentioned him now. You know, Rufus won that Mid-Atlantic belt. He loved that belt.
Yes, he did.
Now there's a development there with the belt. Oh,
yes.
And Slater give it to Koloff.
And Koloff now says that he's the champion.
Well, I wonder
if Rufus, Dick Slater.
I know Rufus loved that belt. He wants to get it back.
Yeah.
No matter who's got it.
You can almost say that about Dick Slater. Bob Orton Jr. gave him the U.S. belt. Because
he certainly did.
To win it.
He certainly did. And he should wear half of it.
That's right. All right, Mark Youngblood.
Wow! Oh, 6 or 7 feet in the air goes Gary Rowe. Mark Youngblood shoots him up. Full body slam. Double top of hot chop. Lateral presses could be it, David.
Well, instinct kicks out. All right, that headbutt in the mid session knocks the wind out of Mark.
Big Hans Schroeder and the rugged German. Here's a man that's hard to knock down. Into the midsection with that big German military boot that he wears in the ring.
Ooh, yes. All right. Snaps him back with the rope. Mark needs to make that tag. Rufus is there. He's ready for that tag.
Got a lot of mail on Mark Youngblood.
They like him.
They certainly do.
All right, the yell for the knee. Catches him again in that midsection. They're trying to work on it, trying to knock the wind out of him. Slow him down. That's what they need to do.
And there's a full body slam by Gary Royal. Here's Royal off the rope, the tip of the match.
Good tackle.
Picks up, across goes. Oh, big chop. Almost cut Gary Royal too. Another one off the rope. Here's the freight train.
And the freight train starts to roll.
The winners.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, come in right now. A man that gets people bigger and bigger. I'm talking about Gary Hart. Now you have the cat, Ernie Ladd.
I have 6'9", 320 pounds, the ninth wonder of the wrestling world. This man can walk and talk and go wherever he wants because if anybody, I'm saying anybody get in the big cat's way, I have
Angelo Muska.
Let him know about Angelo Bubba.
You're talking about a has-been, a wore-out man. It's a man that can't even play football in the United States. I was all pro in the United States. I had to run Angelo Muska out of the United States to play football in Canada. When you look at me, you look at the best. When my telephone rang and Captain Gary Hart called me and said, I got a job I want you to do. He said, I want you to dismantle Angelo Muska. If I have to whip the father and the son, I'll do that. That's the type of man I am. When you stand 6'9 and weigh over 300 pounds and wear a size 17 shoe, that means I'm capable of covering the ground that my big foot covers.
do whatever he wants to do, David. I don't know if people know this man's background. This man grew up tough. He didn't have it easy like most of you. You know what I mean?
Superstar Jones, who is a disgrace, that greasy rascal. He's a disgrace. I would run him right out. I'm going to run him right out of this area. I'm going to run him out.
You see, the thing is with the big cat, you see, the big cat has had all the advantages in life. But like a lot of you, he took advantage of him. A great star at Grambling University. They still talk about the big cat. The man played basketball. He played football. Played the greatest sport in the world, wrestling. Played it his way. And every time this man goes into the ring, you can be sure before it's over, 6'9", 320 pounds, big cat Ernie Ladd comes out on top. And what about my Mid-Atlantic champion?
Yeah, what about the Mid-Atlantic champion? He didn't win it.
Now, never mind. He's champion.
They gave it to you, right?
Because of my win and loss record. My win record, I'm the number one challenger. And by the decency of a man, a fair man such as Dick Slater, Bob Orloff. You know, I can put these men, I'm gathering a lot of new friends. Ernie Ladd, my Jerry Hart, my good advisor, Bob Orton Jr. and Slater now. All coming over and realizing how great of an athlete that I've been. Koloff is, and respecting that, knowing darn well that Koloff at any given moment would repay the favor back to him. But I must say, a man like Ernie Ladd, Bob Orton Jr., Slater, Gary Hunt, myself, all think alike. They are the rottenest, meanest. They don't care what they have to do to accomplish
it. One thing I will agree.
Now, you must understand.
All three.
Wait a minute. Wait a minute. He does not speak real good English, and sometimes he uses the wrong words. Now, don't.
That's the truth, what he said right there.
Well, he didn't mean it in the essence that you're trying to describe. Okay, let me say this. You look today. You look today. You see Gary Hart with the great Kabuki. You see Gary Hart with evil Don Cornoodle, the pride of the Carolinas. You see Gary Hart with 6'9", 320 pounds. You see Gary Hart with Ivan Koloff. Wherever you see my face, wherever you hear my voice, is where we're going to go. I don't care. It ain't no place that we won't come and beat up anybody that needs to be beaten up. Hey, I like beating up an Italian better than anything because most of the Italians, the best weapon is they eat a whole lot of garlic so they smell bad. But this big cat lad, nothing frightens him.
Let me make something perfectly clear to what's happened in my match recently against Mosca. I was in there. I had no recollection of anything about Don Canoodle coming into the ring to my aid. I didn't know anything about this. Now, Mr. Canoodle is a great athlete, a great wrestler. He lost his